Hello dear students, welcome to Neet Shala. You are tuned into Radio Neet Shala and this is your host Suyashi Vineet. So let's start chapter 9, Biomolecules. The chapter says, there is a wide diversity in living organisms in our biosphere. Now, a question that arises in our mind is, are all living organisms made of the same chemicals? That is, elements and compounds. You have learned in chemistry how elemental analysis is performed. If we perform such an analysis on a plant tissue, animal tissue, or a microbial paste, we obtain a list of elements like carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and several other and their respective content per unit mass of a living tissue. If the same analysis is performed on a piece of Earth's crust as an example of non-living matter, we obtain a similar list. What are the differences between the two lists? In absolute terms, there is no such difference that could be made out. All the elements present in a sample of Earth's crust are also present in a sample of living tissues. However, a close examination reveals that the relative abundance of carbon and hydrogen with respect to other elements is higher in any living organism than in the Earth's crust. Table 9.1, which we will look ahead in next page. So let me show you first of all table 9.1. where a comparison of elements present in non-living and living matter has been done, adapted from C.N.R. Rao, Understanding Chemistry, Universities Press, Hyderabad. So you can see here, hydrogen, percentage weight of hydrogen in Earth's crust is 0.14, whereas in human body it's 0.5. For carbon, you can see 0.03 in Earth's crust, whereas 18.5 in human body. Oxygen 46.6 in Earth's crust and 65.0 in human body. Nitrogen is present by percentage weight, very little amount in Earth's crust, whereas in human body it is present as 3.3% weight. Sulfur 0.03% in Earth's crust, whereas 0.3% of weight in human body. Sodium 2.8 for Earth's crust, 0.2 for human body. Calcium 3.6 for Earth's crust, 1.5 for human body. Magnesium 2.1 for Earth's crust, 0.1 for human body. Silicon is 27.7% on Earth's crust, whereas it's negligible in human body. So nitrogen is very little in Earth's crust, whereas silicon is negligible in human body. So this was the table 9.1. After that, we are proceeding to 9.1, how to analyze chemical composition. We can continue asking in the same way, what type of organic compounds are found in living organisms? How does one go about finding the answer? To get an answer, one has to perform a chemical analysis. We can take any living tissue, a vegetable or a piece of liver, etc., and grind it in trichloroacetic acid, Cl3CCOOH, using a mortar and a pestle. We obtain a thick slurry. If we were to strain this through a cheesecloth or cotton, we would obtain two fractions. One is called filtrate, or more technically, the acid-soluble pool, and the second, the retentate, or the acid-insoluble fraction. Scientists have found thousands of organic compounds in the acid-soluble pool. In higher classes, you will learn about how to analyze a living tissue sample and identify a particular organic compound. It will suffice to say here that one extracts the compounds, then subjects the extract to various separation techniques till one has separated a compound from all other compounds. In other words, one isolates and purifies a compound. Analytical techniques, when applied to the compound, gives us an idea of the molecular formula and the probable structure of the compound. All the carbon compounds that we get from living tissues can be called biomolecules. I repeat, all the carbon compounds that we get from living tissues can be called biomolecules. However, living organisms have also got inorganic elements and compounds in them. How do we know this? A slightly different but destructive experiment has to be done. One weighs a small amount of living tissue, say a leaf or liver, and this is called wet, and dry it. All the water evaporates. The remaining material gives dry wet. Now, if the tissue is fully burnt, all the carbon compounds are oxidized to gaseous form, CO2, water vapor, and are removed. What is remaining is called ash. This ash contains inorganic elements like calcium, magnesium, etc. Inorganic compounds like sulfur, phosphate, etc. are also seen in the acid soluble fraction. Therefore, elemental analysis gives elemental composition of living tissues in the form of hydrogen, oxygen, chlorine, carbon, etc., while analysis for compound gives an idea of the kind of organic and inorganic constituents, which has been shown in table 9.2. From a chemistry point of view, one can identify functional groups like aldehyde, ketone, aromatic compounds, etc. But from a biological point of view, we shall classify them into amino acids, nucleotide bases, and fatty acids. So let's quickly look into a list of representative inorganic constituents of living tissues. Component and the formula has been given for sodium Na+, potassium K+, calcium Ca++, magnesium Mg++, water H2O, and compounds like NaCl, CaCO3, BO3. 4-3- SO4 2-. Now let's start with amino acids. Amino acids are organic compounds containing an amino group and an acidic group as substituents on the same carbon, that is the alpha carbon. Hence, they are called alpha amino acids. They are substituted methanes. There are four substituted groups occupying the four valency position. These are hydrogen, carboxyl group, amino group, and a variable group designated as R group. Based on the nature of R group, there are many amino acids. However, those which occur in protein are only of 21 types. I'll repeat these sentences once again. The amino acids are also called alpha amino acids. They are substituted methanes. There are four substituent groups occupying the four valency positions. First, hydrogen. Second, carboxyl group. Third, amino group. And fourth, a variable group designated as R group, which we always do even in organic chemistry also. You must be aware that we write R. So, based on the nature of R group, there are many amino acids. However, those which occur in proteins are only of 21 types. The R group in these proteinaceous amino acids could be a hydrogen. The amino acid will be called glycine. A methyl group, then alanine. A hydroxymethyl group, then serine, etc. Three of the 21 are shown in figure 9.1. Let's check figure 9.1. So, this is figure 9.1. Here you can see glycine, where R was hydrogen, alanine, where R was methane, and serine. So, this was only mentioned that depending on R, it could be glycine, alanine, or serine, as I showed you in this figure So let's move ahead. The chemical and physical properties of amino acids are essentially the of the amino, carboxyl and the R functional groups. Based on number of amino and carboxyl groups, there are acidic, basic and neutral amino acids. Acidic amino acid, example glutamic acid, basic lysine and neutral valine. Similarly, there are aromatic amino acids, example tyrosine, phenylalanine and tryptophan. A particular property of amino acid is the ionizable nature of NH2 and COOH groups. Hence, in solutions of different pHs, the structure of amino acid changes. You can see the structure B is called Zwitter ionic form. This one, it's important. So you can check this picture. So let's move forward. Now moving on to lipids. Lipids are generally water insoluble. They could be simple fatty acids. A fatty acid has a carboxyl group attached to an R group. The R group could be a methyl or ethyl or higher number of CH2 groups, 1 to 19 carbons. For example, palmitic acid has 16 carbons including carboxylic carbon. Arachidonic acid has 20 carbon atoms including the carboxyl carbon. Fatty acid could be saturated without double bond or it unsaturated with one or more carbon-carbon double bonds. Another simple lipid is glycerol, which is trihydroxypropane. Many lipids have both glycerol and fatty acids. Here, the fatty acids are found esterified with glycerol. They can be then monoglycerides, diglycerides, and triglycerides. These are also called fats and oils based on melting point. Oils have lower melting point, example, gingerly oil, and hence remain as oil in winters. This is the reason why oils remain as oil in winter. Can you identify a fat from market? Some lipids have phosphorus and a phosphorylated organic compound in them. These are phospholipids. They are found in cell membrane. Lecithin is one such example. Some tissues, especially the neural tissue, have lipids with more complex structures. Living organisms have a number of carbon compounds in which heterocyclic rings can be found. Some of these are nitrogen bases, adenine, guanine, cytosine, uracil and thymine. When found attached to a sugar, they are called nucleosides. If a phosphate group is also found esterified to the sugar, then they are called nucleotides. Adenosine, guanosine, thymidine, uridine and cytidine are nucleosides. Adenylic acid, thymidylic acid, guanylic acid, uridylic acid and cytidylic acid are nucleotides. Nucleic acids like DNA and RNA consist of nucleotide only. DNA and RNA function as genetic material. This paragraph is important. I'll once again read this paragraph. Please hear it very carefully. Living organisms have a number of carbon compounds in which heterocyclic rings can be found. Some of these are nitrogen bases, adenine, guanine, cytosine, uracil and thymine. When found attached to a sugar, they are called nucleosides. When sugar, then nucleosides. If a phosphate group is also found esterified to sugar, then they are called nucleotides. Adenosine, guanosine, thymidine, uridine and cytidine are nucleosides. Adenylic acid, thymidylic acid, guanylic acid, uridylic acid and cytidylic acid are nucleotides. Nucleic acids like DNA and RNA consist of nucleotides only. DNA and RNA function as genetic material. So, see, look at the structure of glycerol. We have already discussed about glycerol. Lecithin, you can check the structure of fats and oils. The lipids, this is the structure of cholesterol. And yes, the sugars, glucose, ribose. You can also see the structure of nitrogen bases, adenine, uracil. You can also look at nucleosides, adenosine, uridine, and nucleotide, adenylic acid. These are the important structures as it is given in NCERT figure 9.1, diagrammatic representation of small molecular wet organic compounds in living tissues. Now moving on to 9.2, primary and secondary metabolites. The most exciting aspect of chemistry deals with isolating thousands of compounds, small and big, from living organisms, determining their structure and, if possible, their synthesis. If one were to make a list of biomolecules, such a list would have thousands of organic compounds, including amino acids, sugars, etc. For reasons that are given in section 9.10, we can call these biomolecules as metabolites. In animal tissue, one notices the presence of all such categories of compounds shown in figure 9.1. This is the figure 9.1 where we discussed about sugars such as glucose, ribose, amino acids, glycine, alanine, serine, fats and oils. Also, we discussed about nitrogen bases, nucleosides and nucleotide. So, these are called primary metabolites. However, when one analyzes plant, fungal and microbial cells, one would see thousands of compounds other than these primary metabolites. Example, alkaloids, flavonoids, rubber, essential oils, antibiotics, colored pigments, scents, gums, spices. These are called secondary metabolites, which are given in this table 9.3. When a primary metabolite have identifiable function and play known role in normal physiological process, we do not at the moment understand the role or the function of all the secondary metabolites in host organisms. However, many of them are useful to human welfare. Example, rubber, drugs, spices, scents and pigments. Some secondary metabolites have ecological importance. In the later chapters and years, you will learn more about this. This is table 9.3. Some secondary metabolites, pigments include carotenoids, anthocyanins, etc. Alkaloids include morphine, codeine, etc. Terpenoids include monoterpenes, diterpenes, etc. Essential oil includes lemon, grass oil, etc. Toxins include abrine, ricin, lectins include concanavaline A. Drugs include vinblastine, curcumin, etc. Polymeric substances include rubber, gums and cellulose. Now moving to 9.3, biomacromolecules. So there is one feature common to all those compounds found in the acid soluble pool. They have molecular weights ranging from 18 to around 800 Daltons approximately. The acid insoluble fraction has only four types of organic compounds, that is proteins, nucleic acids, polysaccharides and lipids. These classes of compounds, with the exception of lipids, have molecular weights in the range of 10,000 Dalton and above. For this very reason, biomolecules, that is chemical compounds found in living organisms, are of two types. One, those which have molecular weight less than 1,000 Dalton and are usually referred to as micromolecules, or simply biomolecules, while those which are found in the acid insoluble fraction are called macromolecules or biomacromolecules. The molecules in the insoluble fraction, with the exception of lipids, are polymeric substances. Then why do lipids, whose molecular weight do not exceed 800 Dalton, come under acid insoluble fraction, that is macromolecular fraction? So lipids are indeed small molecular weight compound and are present not only as such but also arranged into structures like cell membrane and other membranes. When we grind a tissue, we are disrupting the cell structure. Cell membrane and other membranes are broken into pieces and form vesicles which are not water soluble. Therefore, these membrane fragments in the form of vesicles get separated along with the acid insoluble pool, and hence in the macromolecular fraction. Lipids are not strictly macromolecules. The acid-soluble pool represents roughly the cytoplasmic composition. The macromolecules from the cytoplasm and organelles become the acid-insoluble fraction. Together, they represent the entire chemical composition of living tissues or organisms. In summary, if we represent the chemical composition of living tissues from abundance point of view and arrange them class-wise, we observe that water is the most abundant chemical in living organisms. This is table 9.4, average composition of cells. So component water, percentage of total cellular mass 70 to 90%, protein 10 to 15%, carbohydrate 3%, lipids 2%, nucleic acid 5 to 7%, and ions 1%. So that was all about it. Now 9.4, proteins. Proteins are polypeptides. They are linear chains of amino acids linked by peptide bonds, as shown in figure 9.2. Each protein is a polymer of amino acids, as there are 21 types of amino acids, example alanine, cysteine, proline, tryptophan, lysine, etc. A protein is a heteropolymer and not a homopolymer. A homopolymer has only one type of monomers repeating n number of times. This information about amino acid content is important, as later in your nutrition lessons, you will learn that certain amino acids are essential for our health and they have to be supplied through our diet. Hence, dietary proteins are source of essential amino acids. Therefore, amino acids can be essential or non-essential. The latter are those which our body can make, while we get essential amino acids through our diet or food. Proteins carry out many functions in living organisms. Some transport nutrients across cell membrane, some fight infectious organisms, some are hormones, some are enzymes, etc., which we can check in table 9.5. Some proteins and their functions you can look here. Collagen is required for intercellular ground substances. Trypsin is an enzyme, insulin, hormone, antibody, fights infectious agent. A receptor, sensory reception, smell, taste, hormone, etc. GLUT4 enables glucose transport into cell. So collagen is the most abundant protein in animal world, and ribulose, bisphosphate, carboxylase, oxygenase, ribosco is the most abundant protein in the whole of biosphere. And you all must have got questions from this part many times, so please memorize it, and I'll re-repeat the sentence. That collagen is the most abundant protein in animal world, and ribulose, bisphosphate, carboxylase, oxygenase, ribosco is the most abundant protein in the whole of biosphere. Now we come to 9.5, polysaccharides. The acid insoluble pellet also has polysaccharides, Carbohydrates as another class of macromolecules. Polysaccharides are long chain of sugars. They are threads, literally a cotton thread containing different monosaccharides as building blocks. For example, cellulose is a polymeric polysaccharide consisting of only one type of monosaccharides, that is glucose. Cellulose is a homopolymer. Starch is a variant of this but present as a storehouse of energy in plant tissue. Animals have another variant called glycogen. Inulin is a polymer of fructose. In a polysaccharide chain, say glycogen, the right end is called reducing end and the left end is called non-reducing end. It has branches as shown in the form of cartoon, figure 9.2. Starch forms helical secondary structures. In fact, starch can hold I2 molecules, iodine, in the helical portion. The starch I2 is blue in color. Cellulose that does not contain complex helices and cannot hold I2. Plant cell walls are made of cellulose. Paper is made from plant pulp, which is cellulose. Cotton fiber is cellulose. There are more complex polysaccharides in nature. They have building blocks, amino sugars, and chemically modified sugars. Example, glucosamine, N-acetyl, galactosamine, etc. Exoskeleton of arthropods, for example, have a complex polysaccharide called chitin. These complex polysaccharides are heteropolymers. And you can see figure 9.2 diagrammatic representation of a portion of glycogen. You can see this. So let's proceed to 9.6, nucleic acids. The other type of macromolecules that one would find in acid insoluble fraction of any living organism is the nucleic acid. These are polynucleotides. Together with polysaccharides and polypeptides, these comprise the true macromolecular fraction of any living tissue or cell. For nucleic acids, the building block is a nucleotide. I repeat, for nucleic acids, the building block is a nucleotide. A nucleotide has three chemically distinct components. One is a heterocyclic compound, the second is a monosaccharide, and third is a phosphoric acid or phosphate. As you noticed in figure 9.1, the heterocyclic compound in a nucleic acid are the nitrogenous bases named as adenine, guanine, uracil, cytosine, and thymine. Adenine and guanine are substituted purines, while rest all are substituted pyrimidines. The skeletal heterocyclic ring are called as purine and pyrimidine, respectively. The sugar found in polynucleotides is either ribose, a monosaccharide pentose, or 2-deoxyribose. A nucleic acid containing deoxyribose is called deoxyribonucleic acid, DNA, while that which contains ribose is called ribonucleic acid or RNA. Now comes 9.7, structure of protein. Proteins, as mentioned earlier, are heteropolymers containing strings of amino acids. Structure of molecules means different things in different contexts. In inorganic chemistry, the structure invariably refers to the molecular formula, example NaCl, MgCl2, etc. Organic chemists always write a two-dimensional view of molecules while representing the structure of the molecules, example benzene, naphthalene, etc. Physicists conjure up the three-dimensional view of molecular structure, while biologists describe the protein structure at four levels. The sequence of amino acids, that is the positional information of in a protein, which is the first amino acid, which is the second, and so on, is called the primary structure of a protein. A protein is imagined as a line. The left end is represented by first amino acid and the right end is represented by last amino acid. The first amino acid is also called N-terminal amino acid. The last amino acid is also called C-terminal amino acid. The left end is represented by first amino acid and right end by last amino acid. First amino acid is N-terminal, whereas the last amino acid is C-terminal amino acid. Point to be remembered. A protein thread does not exist throughout an extended rigid rod. The thread is folded into the form of helix, similar to a revolving staircase. Of course, only some portions of the protein threads are arranged in the form of helix. So before that, let's see figure 9.3, primary structure of a portion of hypothetical protein. NNC refers to the two termini of every protein. Single letter codes and three letter abbreviations for amino acids are also indicated. For serine, SER, cysteine, CYS, tyrosine, TYR, and glutamic acid, GLU. So you can check this figure 9.3. Now let's move. In proteins, only right-handed helices are observed. Other regions of the protein thread are folded into other forms in what is called secondary structure. In addition, the long protein chain is also folded upon itself like a hollow woolen ball, giving rise to tertiary structures. Figure 9.4a and b. And this is a secondary structure and figure B is a tertiary structure of protein. This gives us a three-dimensional view of a protein. Tertiary structure is absolutely necessary for many, many biological activities of proteins. Some proteins are an assembly of more than one polypeptide or subunits. The manner in which these individual folded polypeptides or subunits are arranged with respect to each other, example, linear string of spheres arranged one upon each other in the form of cube or plate, etc., is the architecture of a protein, otherwise called the quaternary structure of protein. Adult human hemoglobin consists of four subunits. Two of these are identical to each other, hence the two of subunits are of alpha type and the two subunits of beta type together constitute the human hemoglobin. Two alpha and two beta. 9.8, nature of bond linking monomers in a polymer. Okay, so I hope the time is, it's 32.48 second, but still, okay, we will continue. I think we should continue and, yeah, or should I pause this session here? Because this chapter is a little long. Okay, so let's do this at least. 9.8, nature of bond linking monomers in a polymer. In a polypeptide or a protein, amino acids are linked by a peptide bond which is formed when carboxyl COOH group of one amino acid reacts with amino group of the next amino acid with the elimination of water moiety. The process is called dehydration, as you know it already. In a polysaccharide, the individual monosaccharides are linked by a glycosidic bond. This bond is also formed by dehydration. This bond is formed between two carbon atoms of two adjacent monosaccharides. In a nucleic acid, a phosphate moiety links the 3- carbon of one sugar of one nucleotide to the 5- carbon of the sugar of succeeding nucleotide. The bond between phosphate and hydroxyl group of sugar is called an ester bond. As there is one such ester bond on either side, it is called phosphodiester bond. Figure 9.5, you can see one is on the upside and one is on the downward side. So it is phosphodiester bond. Nucleic acid exhibits a wide variety of secondary structures. For example, one of the secondary structure exhibited by DNA is the famous Watson-Crick model. This model says that DNA exists as a double helix. The two strands of polynucleotides are antiparallel, that is, run in the opposite direction. The backbone is formed by sugar phosphate sugar chain. The nitrogen bases are projected more or less perpendicular to this backbone but face inside. A and G of one strand compulsorily base pairs with T and C respectively on the other strand. A and C, T and G. You can see here. There are three hydrogen bonds between G and C. Each strand appears like a helical staircase. Each step of ascent is represented by a pair of bases. At each step of ascent, the strand turns 36 degrees. One full turn of helical strand would involve 10 steps or 10 base pairs. Attempt drawing a line diagram. The pitch would be 34 angstrom. The rise per base pair would be 3.4 angstrom. This form of DNA with the above mentioned salient features is called bDNA in higher classes. You will be told that there are more than a dozen forms of DNA named after English alphabets with unique structural features. Now, I'm ending this session here. Please like, share and subscribe to your NEET Shala and do use this audio clip. And this is Suyashi Vineet signing off. Thank you.